All right. I'd like to welcome the internet to the program today. Today I'm going to talk about the father versus the other father. And I'm going to try to bring out some things I hope that'll help us. In Romans chapter 8, verse 9, Paul said to the Romans, "But you're not in the flesh, but in the Spirit, if so be the Spirit of God dwell in you. Now if any man have not the Spirit of Christ, he is none of his." And like I've said before, he identified the Spirit of God as the Spirit of Christ, which we know later in Paul's writings is that Holy Spirit of promise in Ephesians. Verse 10, "And if Christ be in you, the body is dead because of sin, but the Spirit is life because of righteousness." And that matches Galatians 2:20 right down the line. "I'm crucified with Christ," and the whole verse. Verse 11, "If the Spirit of him that raised up Jesus from the dead dwell in you, he that raised up Christ from the dead shall also quicken your mortal bodies by his Spirit that dwelleth in you." And that's the possibility, obviously, of two things. One, you were dead in trespasses and sins, now you're alive in Christ. Furthermore, the hope that he can change your vile body and fashion it likened to his glorious body, Philippians 3:21. Because the identification of the redemption is that Holy Spirit of promise which seals you. And again, that's Ephesians 1:13, 14, and 15. Verse 12, "Therefore, brethren, we are debtors not to the flesh to live after the flesh," not in the flesh. You understand, after and in are not the same things. Romans 8:1, "There is therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus who walk not after the flesh." Then is in and after in the same verse and not the same thing? Yes or no? Are you alive? After is to follow after. In is to be in something. Okay, verse 1 again, "There is therefore now no condemnation to them or which in," where? In Christ Jesus. I'm crucified with Christ, nevertheless I live. Being in Christ, we're in one body. And so forth and so on. But then the verse says, who walk not after the flesh, not in the flesh. You are walking in the flesh physically, but you're not in the flesh spiritually. Romans 8:9. But you're not what? Now you try to convince that to a lost person. What you convince the lost people is they need to quit sinning. That's what people believe. How do you do that in the flesh? You ever met anybody that quit sinning? I ain't. Maybe you know some nice people. But everybody's got anger. They've got motives. They've got things involved. They've got secrets that they don't want anybody to know. And they sure wouldn't want to confess everything they knew. So in the flesh, you could be physically walking in the flesh and be carnal. But to be in the Spirit, you're spiritually minded, not carnally minded. See, carnally minded versus being carnal is flesh. Carnal is flesh. Carnally minded is the service of God. Are you going to serve God in the mind, the law of God, or the flesh, the law of spirit? Well, you can't get away from the flesh, so you're carnal even though you're spiritually minded. You are in the flesh, but you're not walking after the flesh. All right, is everybody okay with me so far? Okay, now watch. If you're not, I'm not going to repeat it. Verse 13, "For if you live again," what does it say? Not in the flesh, after the flesh you shall die. The preaching today is mostly on the fact that they're preaching the fact that you're in the flesh and what you're doing in the flesh is separating you from God. If you're in the flesh, you cannot what? Cannot please God. But you're not in the flesh, but in the Spirit. And if I'm not mistaken, that's a capital S. If he's talking about your spirit, it'll be a little S. Okay? Verse 13 again. "For if you live after the flesh, you shall die." Whoa, 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 hold the phone. If there ain't no difference between in and after, what's going to happen to everybody in this room? Okay. Well, then how do you go and we which are alive and remain should be caught up? Is everybody all right so far? I mean, come on, folks. You got to look at verses and see what it says. And it's my job to show them to you. But now watch again. He said, but if through the Spirit do mortify the deeds of the body. All right? That is a mental thing to where you identify that you cannot please God. You cannot come to God. You cannot save yourself. You can't do anything. You mortify what this flesh can do. Haven't you ever thought about why should God take you to heaven? Considering what you promised him the other day and then did it again. And did you confess all your sins or forget some? See what I'm saying? So the verse says, but if through the Spirit's going to lead you to tell you everything the flesh does is sin. Look back in chapter 7. Verse 25, I thank God through Jesus Christ our Lord. So then with the mind I myself serve the law of God. But with the flesh, what? The law of sin. If it's a law, what is the flesh going to do?
Sin.
But wait a minute. The law of sin is, it's going to die. It didn't say sin. It said the law of sin. What does the law of sin? Wherefore by one man sin entered the world, and death by sin, for death has passed upon all men, for all have sinned because of sin. Right? Then if you quit sinning today, what will the law of the flesh still do? You'll still die. And the issue that God's trying to present, the Father, God the Father in heaven, is trying to show us, I will give you eternal life even though you are what you are, because my Son gave you access to me by his dying for your sins. Everybody okay? Now, I suppose you want me to repeat that, right? Verse 25. Here it is. I thank God through Jesus Christ our Lord, so then with the mind I myself serve the law of God. Is a law of God established that will never go wrong if it's a law of God? Okay? Well, how do you serve the law of God? Mind. Then what would you believe in your mind? Chapter 8, verse 13. For if you live after the flesh, you shall die. But if through the Spirit, do what? The law of God is telling you to mortify the deeds of the body and trust the work of Christ. Okay? Verse 14. For as many are led by the Spirit of God, they are sons of God. All right, what's the leadership? Galatians chapter 5, verse 18. If you be led of the Spirit, you're not under the law. What will the law make you do? Confess sins. Are you listening? All your neighbors that go to church and talk to their father? Now let's get on with it. Verse 15. For if you have not received the spirit of bondage again to fear, but you received the spirit of adoption whereby we cry what? Abba, Father. Okay? Abba meaning Father. Look with me in Mark 14. Personally, I believe the Abba probably is the spiritual side of it, and the Father would be the outward statement. Inward, we would cry for the Abba, the Father. Outward, we would cry for the Father in our prayers. Abba, Father, was Jesus Christ in the flesh? And I'm not trying to trick you. Was he in the flesh? Absolutely, he lived in the flesh, right? He said, Abba, Father. Abba, Father. So inside him is groaning to go in the joy back to the Father. And the flesh is seeing something. What's going to happen to him? And suffered and die and in torment of hell. Right? So, Abba, Father, okay? Do we, in our inward self, groan, as in Romans chapter 8? To be released, right? Why do you go to the doctor? And why do you ask the Father to heal your flesh when it ain't worth a damn anyway? Isn't that amazing? We do that, don't we? The flesh has failed you because it's sinful. Everything usually that happens to us is because of something we do. Yes? You're going to go do it after a while. There's probably something back there you shouldn't be eating. I mean, you're just going to clamp down on that sugar. You know, you go to eat, and somebody says, where's dessert? Where's the dessert? Flesh. All right, Mark 14. Now watch, verse 36. And he went forward a little and fell on the ground and prayed that if it were possible, the hour might pass from him. What's in fear? I'm just asking you something. Are you schizophrenic?
Yes.
What fears and what if you're saved doesn't? The flesh fears, the spirit prays. Your flesh don't trust Christ. You doubt. You try to get it right with God. What does the Spirit do? It quotes Scripture. Are you with me? Now watch this. Is Jesus in the flesh? Amen. Does he fear? Did he weep? Was he tired? Okay, watch. He says in verse 36, and he said, Abba, which means Father, Father, all things are possible unto thee. Take away this cup from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but thy will be done. What are you hearing? You're hearing the flesh say, take it away. Right? And the Spirit say, nevertheless, not my will, thy will be done. Correct? You ever went to bed and say, Lord, God, oh Father, sustain me tonight that I may wake up tomorrow? I got to go on vacation now. You know how easy it'd be for you to die in your sleep? I don't care whether you're young or old. You know how easy it'd be? You'd never know it. And you couldn't stop it. But I got news for you. You can't stop it when you're awake. So he cries, Abba, Father. What were we given the right to do? Okay, turn to Galatians chapter 4. Since we have our food here, we can go a couple of hours. Yeah, right. I'll be standing here by myself. Galatians 4:6. But when the 4:4. I apologize. No, I for time's sake, because I really want to get into it. Verse 6. And because your sons, God has sent forth the Spirit of His Son into your hearts, crying what? God does not hear. They said the sin of a prayer of a sinner. What would make God hear your prayer? Abba, Father, His Spirit. See what I'm saying? Did He give you the right to cry, Abba, Father?
Yes.
Okay. Does the Spirit maketh intercession with groanings which cannot be uttered? Yes, it does. All right, turn to Romans chapter 1. In Romans chapter 1, verse 7. To all that be in Rome, beloved of God, called to be saints, grace to you and peace from God our Father. You understand that? God our Father. Look with me in 2 Corinthians chapter 1. Do you have a pain there, George? 2 Corinthians chapter 1. I thought you had a growing pain or something there. All right, 2 Corinthians 1:3. Blessed be God, even the Father of who? And the Father of what? Mercies. Why are you saved? By the mercy of God. He's a God of mercy. You know, people sometimes they claim and they get mad. They get mad at God because things happen to them. And I have told you this time and time. When we had the wreck, I never even thought about it being God's fault. That didn't cross my mind. God is merciful. I thought he was merciful that I landed on my butt and didn't get a head injury. It was not even a concern of the fact that God was trying to kill me. That wasn't God trying to kill me. That was a car. And a cell phone. No doubt she was on a cell phone. I don't think when I'm in trouble that God's trying to kill me. Do you? It's just part of the world. I mean, you got too many verses to tell you we're counted as sheep for the slaughter. Adversaries, time and season, Ecclesiastes chapter 3. I mean, all things work together for good, do they or do they not? Well, then God, and I got the verse I always go to, precious in the eyes of the Lord is the death of his saints. So death in the eyes of God to a saint is precious. Why? He's fixing to bring them to him. And Paul talks about it, it's far greater to be where? And if Paul can't tell you that after being stoned to death, he said, was he caught up in the third heaven? Heard unspeakable words? And then when he woke up, he said, oh, I'm back. He didn't say that, but you can imagine, oh my gosh, I'm back. You know, it's like that. I mean, gee whiz. I remember when they operated on my ankle and put the plate in there. You know, when you operate on you count 100 backwards and you get to 99, you're out. Just bloop. And you really don't dream in that kind of thing. There's no dream when they put you under hardly. Now, some people may, but I every time I've ever been put under, you don't dream anything. You're just like dead to the world. And then you wake up and you go, I'm back. And you realize your ankle's hurting and you're still in this cotton picking hospital. So there are things that we understand. Paul, I'm back. And then he said, I joy in the fact that I can witness to people I hate, Gentiles, heathen, for Christ's sake. If you got somebody or some race you don't like, get over it. For Christ's sake. Do you believe all men can be saved? Well, then act like it. Say, I don't like the way they are. Well, they don't like you either. Don't live under another father. There's another father that teaches that. Now, go with me to Ephesians chapter 3. You understand, there's a holy father and there's another father. There's another son and there is the Holy Son. There's another spirit and there's the Holy Spirit. And they run right with each other. And the idea is to get you to follow the wrong one. Okay? In Ephesians chapter 3, look with me at verse 14. For this cause I bow my knees unto God, unto the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. So if I was bowing my knee, wouldn't I need to make sure who I was bowing to? Correct? I'm just saying that to you, right? Okay. Ephesians 2. Verse 11. Were the Ephesians religious at Ephesus? Oh, my gosh, Diana, the Temple of Diana, one of the world's great wonders. Was Athens in Acts 17, was he saw them superstitious in their religion? Okay, Ephesians 2:11. Wherefore, remember that you being in time past Gentiles in the flesh, who are called uncircumcision by that which is called the circumcision in the flesh made by hand, that at that time you were without who? Now, if you were without Christ, and you're calling God the Father, you wouldn't know that he was the Father of Christ. Right? So you might be calling the wrong father, you reckon? But that isn't all the verse. That you were without Christ, being aliens from the commonwealth of Israel, strangers from the covenant of promise, having no hope without God in the world. Turn to Acts 17 and watch what I'm talking about. You need somebody. They needed somebody. Paul came to Athens. And look what he told them. In Acts 17, verse 22, then Paul stood in the midst of Mars Hill and said, you men of Athens, I perceive in all things you're too superstitious. Do you know a lot of religious superstitious people? You ever had a black cat cross in front of you? Do you know what happens if a black cat crosses in front of me? He gets run over. I'm not dodging him and I ain't scared of him. My car's bigger than him. He's out of luck. He's out of luck, not me. You run across, you got going to make me swerve. I'm going to run over you. That's the only fair thing to do, isn't it? And if he's black, he just got hit with a black truck. Okay? I just hit a deer, or a deer hit me the other day, but he wasn't black. But now watch. For as I passed by and beheld your devotion. What do you know about the word devotion? Isn't that religious? Okay. Found an altar. What's an altar? Religious. With this inscription, this do in remembrance of me.
It's always in all caps, too.
Yeah. It says, to the unknown God, whom therefore you ignorantly. What's the word worship? Is that a religious word? Worship. Him declare unto you, God that made the world and all things therein, seeing he is the Lord of heaven and earth. Uh-oh, what's the end of that verse? Okay, where did everybody go this Sunday morning? And what did they ignorantly think? Why did they think that altar said this doing remembrance of me? Is everybody okay? You understand what you're reading? Now, what do they think of Paul here? And God sent him to Athens to deliver this message to show them who God is and who Christ is. And they're worshiping, and they don't know either. A person can walk into a building and call it Heavenly Father's building, and it ain't. They're calling on another father called Baal. And he's got altars, and he's got religious ways. And all the time they think they'll go to God into their life because of what they did, and he has blinded them, lest the light of the glorious gospel of Christ should shine unto them, because when you talk to them, they will not receive you. Okay. Look with me in John chapter 4. In John chapter 4. I'm a mean old feller, ain't I? In John chapter 4, verse 23, but the hour cometh and now is when the true worshipers shall worship the Father in spirit and in truth. For the Father seeketh such to worship him. And remember, nobody seeks after God. No, they don't seek God. They don't seek after God. They go after God. Oh, they're religious. They go every Sunday morning, Sunday night, Tuesday night, Wednesday night, Thursday night, all that. They seek God. And they seek to get God's approval in what they're doing, but they're not seeking after God. For he said, there's none that seeketh after God, according to who he is. Now watch. God is a spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. There is no other way, okay? Now watch. Turn with me to Ephesians chapter 4. Now here's the truth. I hear people say, well, we worship, everybody's worshiping God is just different ways. We're all worshiping the same God. No, you ain't. Ephesians chapter 4, right? Already we just read how you worship God, right? In spirit and in truth, okay? Ephesians chapter 4, verse 6, 5. One Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is above all, through all, and in you all. Okay? Oneness. The oneness of him. All right, now, Matthew 23. Now, if there's one God and one worship of God, maybe there's another God. And you can show this to a Catholic, and he's got it in his Bible, and he won't believe you. In Matthew 23:9, and call no man your father upon the earth. Do they? Is that a little F? For one is your, what's the F? Capital. Which is where?
In heaven.
Okay. God is a spirit. God is invisible. No man has seen God at any time. I hear people all the time, I saw God. Or I saw Jesus. Well, 1 Timothy 6, you're lying. Other passage, you're lying. You never saw God. God is an invisible God. It's in Titus. If God's invisible, you didn't see God. If you did see God, you might have saw another God. You might have seen the light when you died, they said, because I went to the light. Well, maybe you're in a tunnel. It's a train. Maybe Josh is coming. I had to work 5 tunnels where I worked on a railroad, and you didn't want to see a light coming. You got to wake Leroy up because he ain't never seen a wreck like we're fixing to have. A light is not what you want to see in the tunnel except the end of the tunnel when you're leaving it. Because if you're seeing a light, you got trouble. Because there's no, backing up and turning around. Somebody asked me one time, how do you steer an engine? I said, well, a steering wheel, don't you know? You ever had that one asked, Josh? I have. I had a person ask me, he said, how do you steer an engine? And you look at him like, wow. Look with me in John chapter 8. So are they told? And it is, I'm telling you, it's in the Catholic Bible, call no man your father, which is upon the earth. Do they? Yes, they do. Why do they do it? Because they've been told to do it. Who told them to do it? Well, their leaders. Why are their leaders telling them to do that? Because there's a God of this world that wants it to be called that. Right? Now watch, John 8. A lot of people take this verse and try to make it out that the Jews are the problem of the world. Sin is the problem. Or you want to blame anybody, blame Adam. Don't blame the Jews. In John 8, look with me in verse 44. You are of your little f, your father the devil, and the lust of your father you will do. He was a murderer from the beginning and abode not in the truth. Now you know what murder is? Hatred. Remember I told you it's in John, 1 John. If you just hate somebody, you're the same as a murderer in 1 John. Be careful who you try to hate. How do you hate somebody and try to be charitable to them? If you're charitable to them, you're not hating them. So I don't like that guy. It didn't say you don't like somebody. It said hatred is murder. Well, I mean, where did you ever see the devil murder? In his own hands. What did he get Cain to do? Over what? Religion. All wars are religious, folks. It's based on somebody not believing the same thing. The Japanese didn't believe in our God. I mean, there's a lot of things involved that people don't look at, but whatever. All right, now watch. Turn with me to Matthew 4. Matthew 4. What is he? Verse 1. Then was Jesus led up of the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted of the devil. There's a couple of verses in the Bible that give the capital D to the devil. Here it doesn't. It says tempted of the devil. Okay? Now, I want you to turn with me to Matthew 9. Now, hopefully I can bring this out to you. In Matthew 9, verse 32. As he went out, or as they went out, behold, they brought to him a dumb man possessed with a devil, not the devil. I want you to understand that. A devil. And when the devil, that a devil he's talking about, when the devil was cast out, the dumb spake, and the multitudes marveled, saying, it was never so seen in Israel. Okay? But the Pharisees said, he casteth out devils through the prince of the devils. Now, who do you think the prince of the devils are? Is? Turn to Matthew 12. And I want you to keep this in mind about this individual. All right, 24. When the Pharisees heard, they said, this fellow doth not cast out devils, but by Beelzebub, the prince of the devils. The word Beelzebub is not a Jewish name. It is a heathen deity. And this heathen deity is called the Lord of the Fly. Now, what do you think about flies? What do you know about flies? What's their big food? Dead, right? Something dies, flies go after it. The Lord of the Flies. Beelzebub. It's a heathen deity. And they're saying that this man, Jesus, is casting out the devils by Beelzebub. Jesus said, if a man separates his kingdom, it'll fall. Are you listening? If a man separates his kingdom, it'll fall. If a man's casting out devils, he'll make his thing fall. I don't know if I can, I'm trying to get this over to you. The Lord is casting out devils out of his kingdom. The true casting out. Amen. Lying signs and wonders. Now, what were the apostles given power to do? Go to Matthew 10. Now, who's the God of this world? Not necessarily. It's Satan. Beelzebub, just that heathen deity that they're talking about. Folks, the word devil, there is a devil and there's devils. And you have to go through there and check out the devils versus the devil. The devil's got his devils working. And his devils could be apostles. Judas, you are of your father the devil. Judas, you are a devil. I mean, he's not the devil. He's working for the devil. 30 pieces of silver, he's hired out to work for the devil. Hello? The people that work for the devil believe that great gain is godliness. 1 Timothy 6, for they have the love of money, and it's the root of all evil. Am I making any sense to you? All right, now watch, Matthew 10. He names the 12 apostles in verse 5. These 12 Jesus sent forth, command them, saying, go not in the way of the Gentiles, and in any of the city of Samaritans, any not. We'd rather go to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. And as you go, preach, saying, the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Heal the sick, cleanse the lepers, raise the dead, cast out. What? Devils. Not the devil. Devils. I personally believe they can't handle the devil. And neither can you. Ain't nobody in this room handle the devil. And Jude said, thou dost not rail an accusation against him. Unwarranted. Now, that's not, quote, unwarranted. In other words, don't be around trying to take care of the devil yourself. You'll lose. He's the God of what?
This world.
This But he has devils, and they work. And those devils, these men could what? They could what? They could cast out. Keep bearing with me. Turn to... No, go ahead.
What you're saying is the word Beelzebub is not another name for the devil, like Lucifer.
It's what they're saying it is.
But it's not the same.
It doesn't list it in Revelation 20, does it?
No.
No. That's a heathen deity. God, a lord of the flies. That's, they're using that name. See, they ain't even correct. It's amazing. Look at Luke 11. Maybe I'm doing something wrong. Everybody okay? Luke 11. In Luke 11, 18. If Satan also be divided against himself, how shall his kingdom stand? Because, next two words, ye say. You see that? You say this, he said, that I cast out devils through Beelzebub. And if I, by Beelzebub, cast out devils, by whom do your sons cast them out? Ooh. He's asking him a question. But he said, what I want to key on that verse is, you say. If you go back to Matthew 5, where Jesus installed the six laws that he gave, it said, it's been said, or you say, but I say. You say, but I say. Had they changed the laws? Had they traditionalized their laws? So they changed them. So you say. He didn't say, the Father said. Matthew 15, he said, thou shalt honor thy father and mother. But you say. If a man doesn't honor his father and mother, but offers an offering, a gift, a sacrifice, then it'll be okay. That's like the mafia joining the Catholic Church. If you offer up an offering, then you'll be accepted. How do you think preachers judge people? There you go, Harold. That's exactly how they judge them. That's how they're judged. The preachers judge if that person's given. What is it when you side up with somebody because they give you more? What do they call that word? You're their friend more than other people? Because they didn't give as much. Being partial. Being partiality. The Lord said don't do it in partiality. Why? In the offerings of the Old Testament, some people didn't have an ox to give, and there were certain offerings they could give, or they could go with their neighbor and bar. Partiality is the preacher sees who gives the most, and he's the friendliest to them. Yes or no? Say yes, no. Oh, yeah. So, look with me in Matthew 15. I mean, did it make them right not to honor their father and mother by the gift they give? Well, no, it didn't change the law, did it? Folks, you can't change the law just because you want to change the law. The law is spiritual, is good. I'm not under the law because God said I wasn't under the law. But I didn't change the law. I established the law in Christ. Christ fulfilled the law. He kept it perfectly. I couldn't do that if I wanted to. He set the standard. The curve is unattainable. Did you have a curve when you were in college? A grading curve? There's always somebody ruining it, wasn't there? Yeah. Did you beat them up? You might have been setting it. I don't know. I mean, you got this curve and somebody just ruins you in there. Because they're just incredibly Leonard on, what's his name on Big Bang? You know, he's a legend in his own mind. I mean, come on, they set that curve, and there you are, and you can't attain it. Well, how many have sinned in this room? What did he come short of? That's right. It was standard set, and you just might as well forget it. That's where that submission, that's where you trust that even though you can't make it, he made it for you. Very clear. It's simple. What did I tell you? Matthew 15 and Matthew 15, 22. Verse 22, behold, a woman of Canaan came out on the same coast and cried unto him, saying, have mercy on me, O Lord, thou son of David. My daughter is grievously vexed with a devil. A devil had vexed her. I got a few more minutes. Look with me in Matthew 17. In Matthew 17, I believe that's where I want to go. Verse 15. Lord, have mercy on my son, for he is a what? I run into a lot of them this week. Drivers. There's lunatic drivers everywhere, folks. Lunatics. And by the way, we're laughing about that, but don't you understand there are people that are possessed today? That ain't stopped. And they're out to get you, and you don't even know it. Your adversaries. And they come after you in all forms and fashions. And maybe something helped you not to get that. I mean, I had a guy cross the road on me the other day, yesterday. I mean, he's coming over, and I've got my grandkids in there, and I'm looking at and I just, what are you doing, you? And I want to say certain words. And as I got over, and he went on by, idiots. And you know what? It's a cell phone, probably. I'm sure the cell phone is a great, great tool of the devil. We're not ignorant of his devices. Drivers with cell phones are lunatics. I mean, you are trying to look, text, and drive. Your brain only works so well, a working way. And most of the brains don't work anyway. And you're training that on three different things. And then the other arms. So you got this brain, this side of the brain, this side out of the eyeball, this side up here. And the poor slob meeting you is fixing to get hit. Because you're a lunatic. Now watch. He said, lunatic and sore vexed. For oftentimes he falleth into the fire and off into the water. And I brought him here to thy disciples. And listen to what it says. What could they not do? Then Jesus answered and said, O faithless and perverse generation, how long shall I be with you? How long shall I suffer you, being him? Bring him hither to me. And Jesus rebuked the devil. Now this one's got a devil sent by his father. Does the devil have his angels? And they're like his sons. Did God have sons of God? Angels in Genesis? Does the devil have his sons? And has he sent one to vex this boy? And the disciples. And you know, if the disciples can't rebuke him, isn't that a true, terrible witness? I'm missing. Isn't that a terrible witness? Look at that. They can't even rebuke that. And Jesus said, how long will I be with you? Bring him here. What had he done in the wilderness? Three times. It is written, it is written, it is written. Right? Who was he with in the wilderness? The devil. Literally the devil. Now they're devils. He's given them the power to cast out what? Devils. And they can't handle this one. And what does he say? Thou perverse and what? I'm missing you. Faithless. Could they do what he gave them the power to do? Why did Peter start sinking in the water? Faith. How do we walk? We'll start walking it. Quit chewing your fingernails over everything you're having trouble with.
Have faith. Take the word of God, written to you, Romans 2, Philemon, and trust God. He won't lie. He can't lie. Don't be faithless. He can take care of it, right?
Pray without ceasing. Pray about everything. Be careful for nothing. Didn't say not be smart about it. It said be careful for nothing. I mean, obviously, if you drive 100 miles an hour and you wreck, it wasn't God's fault. It was your fault. But if you're alive, then God helped you even in your stupidity. Right? I'm trying to get you to see the things that people miss. Look with me in, I haven't got time. Look in Luke 4. This would be a good one to eat chicken on. In Luke chapter 4, verse 33. And in the synagogue there was a man which had a spirit of an unclean devil, and cried out with a loud voice. And I always think about loud voices besides mine preaching. There are people that are loud. There may be a reason. This man cried out with a loud voice. Who's in front of him? Creator of heaven and earth. Verse 34, saying, "Let us alone." Then all the devils are in unity. Their unity is against God. They are against God. Who's standing there? The one that is God, that is with God, that loves the Lord thy God, that does the will of God. Let us alone. Right? Let us alone. What have we to do with thee, thou Jesus of Nazareth? Art thou come to destroy us? I know thee, who thou art. The what? The devils fear and tremble. Let us alone. So I come to a word, and I'll let you eat chicken. Mark 5. And if I don't, I lied, and we'll go on. No. In Mark 5. You may not be interested in this, but folks, this is a great study. In Mark 5, verse 6. But when he saw Jesus afar off, now I ain't got time. Well, I'm going to take time. Verse 1. And they came over to the other side of the sea into the country of the Gadarenes. And when he was come out of the ship, immediately there met him out of the tombs a man with an unclean spirit, who had his dwelling among the tombs. No man could bind him, no, not with chains. This is an incredible individual. This individual's a bad motor scooter. You don't want to meet him. He hurts you. Okay? Because that when he had been often bound with fetters and chains, and the chains had been plucked asunder by him, and the fetters broken in pieces, neither could any man tame him. And always, night and day, he was in the mountains and in the tombs, crying and cutting himself with stones. Yeah, do you remember the Baal worshipers in front of Elijah? Uh-huh. Cutting themselves and calling on their God and all that. Well, let's read on. Verse 6. But when he saw Jesus afar off, he ran and worshipped him. This man's in misery. He's not human acting. And he's in misery, folks. He's hurting himself. He's in total trouble. Verse 7, he cried with a loud voice and said, "What have I to do with thee, Jesus, thou Son of the Most High God? I adjure thee by God that thou torment me not." You know, it's amazing. He figures that God's Son is there to hurt him. He's already hurting. And the devil inside is saying, "Get away.
This is mine. This is mine. You ever read the story about Saul of Tarsus? Who do you think owned Saul? The devil. When the Lord appeared to him, he said, Lord, who art thou? I am Jesus, whom thou persecutest. And the Lord plucked him right out from Satan's hands and saved him. You know who you belong to before you were saved? The devil. But you didn't know that God had bought you. And it was the job of somebody to stand up and tell you, you're bought with a price. What was the price? The shed blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. He died for your sins. He was buried. He rose again the third day. This is God's way of purchasing you. Will you accept him? Will you allow him to come in you by trust? Now watch.
He said, verse 8, for he said unto him, come out of the man, thou unclean spirit. And he asked him, what is thy name? And he answering, saying, my name is capital L, what? Legion, for we are many. You don't think they ain't out there, folks? They're out there. Now, there are three things they do, Matthew 7. People that are led by them, that are taught by them, or trained by them, that other father. In Matthew chapter 7, look in verse 21. Not everyone that saith unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven, but he that doeth the will of my Father which is in heaven. And many, many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in thy name, and in thy name cast out devils, and in thy name done many wonderful works? There you go. They do what? They prophesy, they cast out devils, and they do many wonderful works. Does that sound like religion? Verse 23, and then will I profess unto them, I never knew ye, depart from me, you that work iniquity. The legions are working, and their Father is guiding those bodies that will not surrender to the Lord their temple, but have surrendered to another spirit in another building, in another way, and they're working iniquity. The mystery of iniquity doth already work. Amen?